Good morning and welcome to Grace. Let me do it again. The choir is talking, y'all. Listen, good morning.
Good morning.
Hey now, that's what I'm talking about. It is a joy to be with you this morning. We have had a wonderful morning at Grace and United Methodist Church, starting at 8:30 with Jim Boshin, at 9:30 with Natalie. Her middle name just left me, Hamby. And now we get to hear John Lee. So God is good, right? All right. So I'm Reverend Liza Marler, in case you don't know who I am, but I think you know by now. And I have the opportunity and the privilege to serve this amazing church. I have a few announcements to share with you. First thing I want to share, we're trying to go by date, and you can see all of this on your bulletin, is the Sam's Covered Dish is on Tuesday. Is that right? At 11:30. So bring a dish that'll feed 5 or 6 people. Don't bring this dish. Bring a dish, okay? And come and eat with us. And the police department is going to be giving us a program on scams and fraud. And I think it's really, really important for our seniors, but not only our seniors, but for all of us to be aware about scams and fraud. So if you're not quite over the 55 mark, but you have a big dish you want to bring, come on, we'll let you in. Is that okay? I didn't ask the boss if that was okay, but I think it's okay. The next thing I wanted to mention with you on Sunday, April 21st, which I believe is next Sunday, at the end of this service, we will have a time with Ted, Trenton Edward Dockery, and it'll be an opportunity for you to ask questions, to hear from him and some other leaders in our church, and it's really important that you plan to stay for that short time after worship on the 21st. The next thing I want to share with you is the day of service. How many of you have signed up for the day of service? I was so excited when they told me in missions that we were doing a day of service. I think that's awesome. So if you haven't signed up yet, there's plenty of things that we can do. We, as this church over here on this hill, are going to serve all over the county. It's going to be exciting. Make sure you sign up to participate in the day of service. Now, how many of you are golfers? Oh, you don't want to admit it. That's interesting. Okay, all right. Well, there's a golf tournament coming up on May the 6th, which is 2 days after after the day of the service. Yeah, it's on Monday. Is it on Monday? Yeah, it's on Monday. Make sure this is the United Methodist men's way of creating funds to do the wonderful things that they do with their funds, like scholarships for our high school students and other ministries that they serve. So if you haven't signed up yet, you still have time, and we want to make sure that's a big, special day. I think those are all the announcements that I have at this time. Make sure that you read everything on the bulletin. You know it's right there for you. And there's a pretty young lady that wants to share something with us. I call her Carol. Miss Carol Jordan from our SPRC would like to talk with us.
Good morning, Grayson. So didn't King David say it best when he said in Psalms, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord." I am very happy to be here this morning. I hope y'all are as well. So my name again is Carol Jordan, and I am the chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee. Basically, we're the HR committee for the church. And each year we have business to take care of. So this morning, I'm happy to bring some good news for you. If you're not a lifelong Methodist, you may not know that our pastors serve on an annual basis. Each fall, the district superintendent gathers information from the churches, and they present that information to the bishop and her committee. In the winter, around January, the bishop and her committee go through these this information and provide the input to the churches. So therefore, it is with a heart full of thanksgiving and praise that I can announce that our pastors, Reverend Trenton Dockery and Reverend Liza Marler, have been reappointed to Grayson United Methodist Church for another year. So if you see them out and about, congratulate them, thank them. And we're so grateful for them, and we look forward to another year under their leadership as we grow together in the grace and knowledge of our Lord.
Amen. Amen. That certainly is good news. As we begin this morning, let's take a few moments to pray together. Father God, we thank you this morning for the announcement that Trenton and Liza are coming back for another year of service and ministry and leadership for us, and we pray, God, that you pour your Spirit upon them as they lead us and help us to grow in our faith of you. And Father, I'm reminded of the prelude that the ladies played, "Because He Lives, Life is Worth the Living," as part of the lyric, "Because He Lives." And Father, we thank you for the life that you give us. There are so many reasons for us to love you, so many reasons for us to praise you and to serve you. And Father, this morning, as we worship, we know you are in our presence. Your word says so, that when we gather together, you are there. Your Spirit is here, and we welcome you into this service. And I pray that every word we sing, every word that is spoken, every action we do is to bring you glory and praise, for you are the only one worthy of that. We praise you this morning, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand as we worship together. All hail the power.
How many of you are good proofreaders? You are? What do you see that's incorrect on the back of the bulletin? I'm not trying to point it out other than it's a way to tell you that it's incorrect. Jim Boshin preached on Luke 24, 36 through 48, and John is preaching on Luke 24, 36 through 38. Okay? So I wanted to make sure y'all knew that. Okay, so it was wrong down there. Anyway, it was a way to tell you. Okay. You know what? Read the whole chapter. It'll do you good. It'll do you good. All right. As we come to this time in our worship service, we call this our stewardship time. It's a time for us to think about what we are doing and how we are being the hands and feet of Christ in the world, and how your giving, my giving, our giving, helps to assure that we can do all these things that we do, that's on the front of your bulletin and so much more. We are an extremely blessed church, and God continues to give us ways and means so that we can be Easter people and the hands and feet of Christ out into the world. So this is our time to really think about that and to really give as the ushers prepare to come forward this morning. Yeah. Ushers, hello. Did I not talk long enough? I can talk a little longer, you know. You're multitasking. Y'all are doing it all this morning. God bless you. I didn't talk long enough. Look at those good-looking ushers. Are they not the best? You know, our ushers never get any hallelujah. So let's thank God for our ushers. Yes. Yes. They do a gazillion things. God bless them, and we are grateful for you. And our acolytes. We're grateful to have acolytes as well. All right. Prepare your hearts and minds as this music plays to give. Fill our cups, Lord, not only with your word, your songs, your hymns, the music that we hear. God, fill our cups and make us whole as we give of ourselves, God, so that we can further extend your kingdom even further out into the world. God, we need you. We need you to continue to guide us. And today, God, we lift up to you this church, all of us here, God, for your glory and not our own. God, as we lift ourselves up to you, we ask that you bless these gifts, and may they be used, God, according to your will and for the glory of your kingdom here on earth. God, we also lift up to you those who are suffering illness, those who are hurt and broken and missing loved ones, those, God, who have suffering that is beyond anything we can imagine and need you. God, we also lift our first responders. We lift to you, God, our police officers, as well as our firefighters and our EMTs. God, we lift to you the one no one else is praying for, as well as the one who has not seen your light. May our light shine so that they will see you, God, through each of us. And now, oh God, we pray boldly the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. This is on. There we go. It looks a little different up here than it does. I'm normally sitting out where you're sitting. It looks a little different from up here, different perspective. And we're going to be talking a little about how our perspectives can change today. Before we get into the sermon for today, would you pray with me, please? Lord, I pray you would anoint my lips to speak your word clearly. I pray you'd anoint the hearts and the minds and the ears of those who would hear, that you would speak to them through your word. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in their sight. Our God, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. I want to thank Pastor Trenton for giving me the opportunity to preach today. Thank Liza for assisting today. And to thank all of you for being here today. Before we get into the scripture itself that we're going to mainly focus on, I want to set a little context for us. This account is after Jesus was crucified, after his death and resurrection. It's immediately after Luke tells us of the encounter two disciples had with the risen Lord on the road to Emmaus. The disciples were gathered, and in the midst of talking about this amazing encounter, when we pick up here in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 through 48. Please stand if you're able and hear God's word for us today. You'll notice the disciples' perspective is about to change in a way that rocked their world, in a way that rocks our world as well. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. So imagine sitting around with friends, your closest friends, and talking about a person you all love deeply, a person who has died, a person who's been buried. And then suddenly you look up and that person is right in front of you. How would you react? You might be thrilled to see them, but also perplexed and confused and frightened, like you'd seen a ghost. That's how the disciples reacted. They were startled and frightened. Hard to blame them. Yes, Jesus had told them he was going to die and rise again, but it was too much for them to comprehend. Whenever Jesus talked about his suffering and death, they couldn't bear it. They wanted to change the subject. They didn't want him to die. They didn't even want to think about it. They aren't that much different from us. We don't like to think about someone we love dying. Even for those of us who have the hope of resurrection in Jesus, death is not something most of us are comfortable thinking about, let alone discussing. We want to avoid it. But now the disciples' perspective on death and resurrection is about to radically change. Because Jesus is standing right there before them. They look like they've seen a ghost. The disciples are scared. Jesus understands. He understands that they're afraid, shaken, in need of reassurance. So he speaks words to them that they have heard him say before. Peace be with you. Jesus knows the disciples are human and frail, and he comforts them. And Jesus goes a step further. Jesus helps them see that he is really alive. He is not a ghost. He lets them see his hands and his feet. The disciple Thomas wasn't there at that moment to see it. And later he gets the unfortunate nickname of Doubting Thomas because he, like the rest of the disciples, find the resurrection of Jesus too incredible to believe at first. Later, Jesus offers Thomas nothing more than he's offered the other disciples. Proof. Proof that he is really himself. He asks for some food. They give him some broiled fish, probably a common meal for them, and he eats it. So what's the big deal about eating a meal? Why is that so important? Because ghosts don't eat. Only flesh and blood eats. Jesus is telling them and showing them that it's really him. He is alive. The resurrection is real. Jesus was physically resurrected from the dead. That's important. The Apostle Paul teaches us that the resurrection of Jesus is not only important, it's essential to our faith. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 19, Paul lays out exactly how central the resurrection of Jesus is to our faith. But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then found to be false witnesses about God. For we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. But he did not raise him if, in fact, the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. As he is most of the time, Paul is clear. He's emphatic. Jesus' resurrection is central to our faith. Our salvation depends on it. Without the resurrection, we are left dead in our sin. We have no hope. Those who have died in the faith have no hope. If untrue, then our faith is fake, just a fairy tale. It's useless. But if true, then not only was Jesus raised from the dead, but when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we will be raised to life as well. The resurrection is essential. 15 years ago, this past Labor Day, it was 15 years, I got a call that changed my life, but not in a good way. It was Labor Day, and we were preparing the grill for a fun afternoon. Family time, enjoying some good food on the grill, and then the call. As I picked up the phone, I heard my mom's voice on the other end. My mom is not an outwardly emotional person. She is from strong English stock and believes in keeping a stiff upper lip. But not that day. She sounded broken, sad. She was crying. My mom never cries. And I learned that my dad was dying. In fact, he had died and been brought back more than once through resuscitation. They didn't think he would make it, and I needed to come home right away. And I did. I got on a plane just hours later after the phone call, and on that Labor Day, Dawn made arrangements with the airline that was very accommodating to us to fly out right away. It's all actually pretty hazy even today, but I know we got there as quickly as possible. When I got off the plane, my mom met us at the gate, and I knew what that meant. Dad had died. If he was still alive, Mom would be with him in the hospital. But Dad was gone. And my life would never be the same. I was raised in the church. My mom and dad and our family were strong believers in Jesus. I had faith that my dad was with God. But it hurt. In fact, it still hurts. It's painful. It's the deepest loss of my life. In that hospital room, my dad had stopped breathing, and he was resuscitated several times, but he didn't stay alive. That wasn't resurrection. But because Jesus was resurrected, I have the sure hope that my dad too will be resurrected. I will see him again, not his ghost, him. I know many of you have that same hope for reunion with those who have gone on before you, those who have died in the faith. In his resurrection, Jesus defeated death. And because of his resurrection, we have that same hope. Jesus as simply an idea, Jesus as a good teacher, is not a threat. Not then and not now. Many today admire the idea about Jesus, or their conception of Jesus. Images of Jesus are used to push many agendas, some of which are not based on the scriptures. There's a temptation to make Jesus in our image instead of receiving him as he is. Jesus is seen as a compassionate and loving man, and certainly he was. Someone who lived and died and set an amazing example. He certainly did that. But Jesus is more. Jesus made claims that only God can make. Jesus did things that only God can do. Yes, Jesus was fully human, but he was also fully God. The resurrection is proof. Jesus is who he said he was. Our faith in Jesus Christ is vital because it leads to resurrection. Jesus did rise from the dead. He did walk out of that tomb. It's real. The resurrection of Jesus was physical and real and not simply a metaphor. We need more than a metaphorical resurrection. When I die one day, it won't be a metaphor. It'll be real. And that's why my hope is in the resurrected Jesus. That's our hope. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, And here's where I wish I could fully affirm that hymn, that all fear is gone. But it's not. I still have some fear. I still have some doubts, like those first disciples. Maybe you do too. Jesus understands our weakness. He comes to us and offers us peace. Jesus was indeed raised from the dead. And because Jesus conquered death, I have faith that my dad will rise in Christ with all those who put their trust in Jesus. You can have that same assurance. What a day of rejoicing that will be. Back to our scripture for this morning. After Jesus showed his hands and feet marred by the crucifixion, after he'd eaten the fish, showing he was no ghost, but truly himself in the flesh, Jesus does something else incredible. The gospel tells us that Jesus opened the minds of the disciples so they could understand the scriptures and how they foretold his suffering, death, and resurrection. Without Jesus, they could not possibly understand. Same for us. In our own intellect alone, we can't grasp the truth of the gospel. It is only by the grace of God. Just a verse after our reading ends today in Luke 24, Jesus tells the disciples that after he departs, he would send the Holy Spirit as promised to give them power to be his witnesses. The same Holy Spirit helps us to understand the scriptures and give us power to live for God. We need the Holy Spirit to give us understanding. To give us understanding of the scriptures, to give us the power to live as true disciples of Jesus Christ. Jesus teaches that repentance and forgiveness of sins in his name are to be preached to all nations, starting in Jerusalem. They are to be his witnesses. A few verses later in Luke 24, at the end of the Gospel of Luke, we learn that Jesus ascended into heaven where he lives and reigns today. That's all good and nice and wonderful, but I have questions for us today. Are you a believer in God? Are you a follower of Jesus? Then be his witnesses where you are and where God sends you. Repentance and forgiveness of sins are still what we are to preach, what we are to tell, what we are to live. We are to be witnesses that Jesus is alive. The resurrection is real. If you're not a believer in God, if you're not yet following Jesus, I pray that the Holy Spirit, even now, will open your eyes and open your mind to receive the truth of the gospel. I can't make it happen. I'm not that eloquent. But God is that powerful. Jesus is that real. Jesus was raised from the dead. It wasn't just resuscitation. Jesus was resurrected once and for all. Jesus never died again. He lives. He lives today. He offers salvation today. He calls us to follow him today. Will you?
Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. It's at this time that we prepare to come to the table of Christ. It's not my table. It's not the United Methodist table. It's not Pastor Trenton's table. It's not John's table. Oh, you do need some, though. We all need it, don't we? If you remember on the night when Jesus had supper with his disciples, people like you and me, he took bread and he broke it, gave thanks for it, and then he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And then he took the last cup of wine and he said, "This is my drink. This is my blood. Drink from it, all of you." And so today we remember, as we lift our cups up and we pray, Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of wafer and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be the body of Christ to the world, redeemed by his blood. Make us one with you and one with each other until we come to feast at your heavenly banquet. In your most holy Son's name we pray, and let the people of God say, Amen. So if you will, take your wafer. This is the body of Christ given for you. And your juice. This is the cup of the everlasting blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Oh God, we are grateful for this gift. May it nourish our spirits as we join with your Spirit. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Stand as we close this morning.
Oh, in the great name, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, what the mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He
God for the blessing he gives us to be able to gather together to proclaim the truth of the gospel, to live in that resurrection, to live in that power. So as you go out from here, tell somebody. Be a witness. Tell them with your words. Tell them with your life. Because there's a lot of the world that doesn't know and hasn't experienced. And they won't know if we don't share with them.
Amen.
So take what you've been given and give it to someone else. We're going to now share our faith, our belief, through the Apostles' Creed. You'll notice in there the affirmation of the resurrection, the affirmation of the core principles of our faith. So please, don't just say these words, but proclaim these words as truth. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.